is the feeling. Take me to the garden. I wanna feel my belonging.
Coming up in the Garden of Eden tonight.
You are welcome in the Garden of Eden with your marriage anchor this Sunday evening. Yes, how was your day? Tell the marriage anchor, how has been your weekend? What did you do on Saturday? Today morning, Sunday, did you go to church? And those of you that have been connecting with the marriage anchor, send a message. Tell us what's happening in your farming. Eh, Miss Farmer, Mr. Garden, what is going on? Update us, send testimonies, you guys. It's been 3 years. This is a new year, 2023. We expect new things. I've been teaching, laboring every single Sunday, writing on a Facebook page, on a YouTube channel. What is happening? Am I doing something or I'm wasting time? I can go back home and start farming. Eh? Hey, you never know, twins, so that we can get twins. Eh? I'm still young and just over that. Anyway, you're welcome in the Garden of Eden once again. Of course, as I always tell you, I'm always excited, looking forward to seeing you. Yes, I told you, I see you on the other side of the camera. So tonight in the garden, it is extremely exciting. And like I told you in the previous episode, this year we decided to open up the Garden of Eden and bring in people with different experiences, people of expertise, people that you trust, people that you admire, people that you look up to, people that have walked the journey that we are walking. Yeah, people that have been married for 20, 30, 40, 50, 2, 3, 4 years, people that are dating, people that have had their hearts broken, coming and sharing their experiences, so that as we are walking this journey of returning into the garden, we have some reference point, we have some people we look up to, and we say, if she could do that, yes, even I can do it. So tonight I have a guest. But before I introduce our guest, I'd like to say that if you are a kind of lady that you've been used, you've been abused, you've been harassed sexually by your boss, in the house, a relative, tonight is for you. It is very special. It is at the depth of my heart as the marriage anchor. I meet lots of young girls, ladies, and you meet somebody and they have a challenge trusting their own husband. So they come and tell you, my husband is always on his phone, my husband is always, you know, watching porn, my husband, and it's an imagination. But it has become a bondage, it has become a mountain. Why? Because at a certain time in their life, they had an experience where a certain man took advantage and used them and dumped them. So they have a heartbreak, and so they've developed a stigma towards trusting men. They think every man is a cheat, every man is a liar, there's no man who can't cheat. You've heard these things. Eh? We think they are cliches, but yes, they have a background. So tonight we are going to be tackling sexual abuse in the workplace, the consequences, what happens, and most importantly, if you are in a position where you're being harassed by your boss, by your employers, maybe it is at your school, anywhere, if somebody is harassing you, trying to blackmail you into giving into sex for exchange, for a job, for a let's say, maybe, I don't know if people I would convince you to give in sex for a bonus, for, I don't know, per diem, whatever favor that you can imagine. I want us to look at the consequences and, most importantly, how to save yourself as a lady. What can you do about it? I know this is something that is, you know, always shunned. People don't want to talk about it. You feel shy and you get unlawfully or prematurely dismissed from your workplace and your family is suffering, or perhaps someone will frame you and send pictures to your husband and your marriage is in jeopardy. So basically, we are just here for you tonight, and yes, to discuss this matter or to tell us what we are supposed to do, I have imported an expert. She's a lawyer working with Uganda Human Rights Commission. She's a Miss her counsel. I like calling people counsels. Are you a counsel? Counsel Ruth Ssekindi. Is that the right pronunciation? She's here from Uganda Human Rights Commission. So today we are going to be looking at the legalities involved as you're undergoing the process of getting justice for that man that took advantage of you. Or that woman, I've heard that also men, they are women that are very serious and they'll blackmail you into you taking them to bed or them taking you to bed. I don't know what that is. Okay, Counsel Ruth, you're welcome in the Garden of Eden.
Thank you, Prosie.
You look lovely.
I think you look better, pink, but thank you.
Pink is one of my favorite colors. I love your smile.
Thank you kindly.
Has your husband told you that he loves you?
Oh, I'm told every day.
Oh, so basically, but I think mine has also hit your heart, like I love you. Smile. That's the first thing I noticed when you smile, is like bright and it's beautiful.
Thank you.
Here in the Garden of Eden, we are a people of romance and love and serenity. You come here to relax.
I can see it's beautiful.
Mm-hmm. I know you are a lawyer by profession. So what made you choose to be a lawyer to start with?
That's a very interesting question. Mm. Not many people ever ask me what made me want to be a lawyer. Mm. But I was inspired by a number of things. Mm. When I started off, I always wanted to be a doctor because I think that was what was on vogue for all the kids. Mm. And when I go to hospital, I would love the white gown. Mm. And then so I worked so hard, but I think I loved more reading than maths. And then along the way, I changed. Mm. I used to watch Justice Julia Sabutinde conducting investigations into police. Mm. And I was inspired. And my father would be like, wow, I want you to be like that one. Okay. I was like, maybe one day I will sit and question police officers and very important men and women in this country. Mm. So that inspired me. And before I knew it, I loved this. Okay. So I love what I do. I always tell people, I have the best job around town.
Wow.
It's very fulfilling because you're dealing with the poor, you're dealing with the indigent. Mm. You make a difference in people's lives.
Amen.
Yeah.
So apart from you being a lawyer, who you are, please introduce yourself.
My name is Ruth Ssekindi. I'm a lawyer by profession, an advocate of the High Court and a human rights defender. And I have a beautiful daughter.
Okay.
And I love farming. I love reading. I love mediating conflicts. I love talking to people. So I'm a people person.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. So of all the other departments, I don't know, there are departments, faculties of law. Mm. Why human rights?
I went into human rights. By the way, I started with legislative drafting.
Okay.
Drafting laws. Mm. And so I realized this was not my niche, it was not my calling. Mm. So I jokingly went and applied for a job in the Human Rights Commission.
Okay, jokingly.
And I go, yes, I was like, you know, you see something and like, let me just try this. Mm. But I never thought it would yield too much.
Okay.
And so I went to the interview and I did three interviews and I got three job opportunities in the same institution. And then I had to zero to one. And so I was made a legal officer. And on my first day, and trust me, I was just trying out.
Okay.
Because I wanted to test the terrain. And so the first day, because I thought I would do it for maybe a year and then move out. Okay. The first day I dealt with victims of human rights violation. And the second day, and after that, I was hooked.
Wow.
I wanted to make a difference in people's lives. Mm. And so I have been at it for over 18 years now.
Under Human Rights Commission?
Yes.
Wow.
And it's because of what it entails and the difference that you make in people's lives that makes you get stuck.
Okay.
Because every day is a new challenge and you want to see what the difference you can make in people's lives.
Okay, so what position are you at Human Rights?
So now I'm a director.
Mm.
So the last, you could say 10 years, I was director, complaints, investigations and legal services.
Okay.
And now I'm a director, monitoring and inspections.
Mm.
Yeah.
All right, so let's talk about sexual abuse, starting with the workplace. Maybe start with the young people that are hungry for a job and you've just graduated, you're fresh from university, and then you go submit your application and then you are told, actually, if you want to get this job, supposing, let's take it to 20 years back before you got this big job now that you have, would you have given into sex in exchange for a job?
I don't think so. For the viewers, it's very important to know that traditionally, the woman was not supposed to work.
Okay.
Men, because of their masculinity, even in the Bible, were told to take care of the women. And traditionally, the men were supposed to go and fend for their wives and their families. So when the women started working, it was by default. And we are seeing very many single mothers, very many women trying to work to make ends meet because we realize that the world is changing, it's evolving, and the little income that the husbands bring in is not sufficient. So women started working, one, out of empowerment, but also out of need. And so when they came into this space, the men felt threatened. But also the men have perceptions of what a woman should be. A woman should be nurturing. A woman should not be very aggressive. A woman should be doing certain jobs. That's why when the women started working, they started off as cleaners, cooks, secretaries, because that they're supposed to support. Women were not supposed to be lawyers. You stand in court and you speak and defend someone. How? Women were not supposed to be doctors. And I remember when I first started working, I used to sit with an officer, and he was not a lawyer. He was supposed to support us. And every time complainants would come, they would say, and they say, oh, go to the lawyer in that room. So they would look at me and say, Siviete secretary, Siviete lawyer. So me, I'm the secretary because I'm the woman. But actually, it was the other way around. So women were perceived, or in many cases are still perceived to be, to have lesser jobs with less income. So when we start off and the women are taking certain spaces, the men also feel that women belong somewhere. So men are taught that woman's no means yes, and that a man should not take no for an answer. And that changes the way we raise children. Now, for me, I'm going back to what you asked me.
Yes.
Would I have? My father empowered me. I was coming from a very empowered family.
Okay.
Where my father always told me, you can. I've told you what made me become a lawyer. So I knew that I had to, no man was better than me.
Okay.
And that we're the same level. So when I come in this space, I'm so empowered that I think I'm intimidating. In law school, in our first year, the first lecturer who came in told us, I see you're a number of girls. Okay, you'll be lucky if you get married because you'll be intimidating. Because at the time, and still is, for a woman lawyer, that was very intimidating. They would tell you, she's going to take your property, she's going to take your children.
She knows
she's not
rights.
Submissive, she knows her rights. And so the men are, yes, so most probably I wouldn't. But back to sexual harassment. Sexual harassment and abuse, and I'm trying to blend them together, happen because of many reasons.
Okay.
One, we have also to understand what is sexual harassment. It is any wanted sexual advance, whether physical, whether it is a request, any unwanted request, it is a gesture. It is, for example, someone looking at you and staring at you and you say, excuse me. It could be touching your body part. It could be showing you obscenities that you're not comfortable with. It's any sexual act or indication that is not wanted. Now, our men have been told that a woman's no means yes, that women enjoy it. And then they ask you, why did you wear that dress? I thought you wanted to please me.
I know.
They're also telling you, hey, if we hit at you, you complain. If we don't hit at you, you complain. In any case, women are very many in the country and in the world. We're just helping you. So sexual harassment is looked at as a favor by the male race. So all these perceptions and all these narratives create an impression on men and on young men that it's okay. And the women have also been told it is normal. It's okay for the men to hit at you and do whatever they do to touch your breast, to touch your butt, to touch your private without you wanting, because you're a woman and he's doing you a big favor, because women are many in the world. So this is unacceptable, and yet we have normalized it. So the workplaces should also have zero tolerance for sexual abuse and sexual harassment. And yet many women struggle in silence, because we have found that 3 in every 5 women, working women, have been sexually harassed or there's a sexual abuse somewhere. Because sexual abuse is really more like it has happened, but it starts with the harassment sometimes and ends up in the actual abuse. Actual abuse including the rape and defilement. Okay, those are children. Okay. But yes, so when we are speaking about it, we have to blend in the harassment itself and the abuse. And women struggle silently, or they are so afraid of speaking because they will be called names. And because in many cases, we see men as being the ones who take the leadership roles, the superior roles. You see, issues of gender are very complex. When you think about a secretary or a cook, what do you think? Who do you think about? A woman.
A woman.
When you think about a household, who do you think of?
A woman.
Can the man do it? Will his hands fall off?
No.
Or will his private part fall off?
Mm-mm.
No, never. But there are jobs that we think are for women because they are beneath. So when we think about a professor, a doctor, when you think about an engineer, what do you think? A tall guy who's eloquent and speaking a lot of English. Do you understand? So we have equated men for certain position. And then during recruitment, when you're recruiting and a woman, a small, short woman enters, unless she's very good, you'll be like, will she be able to supervise?
Will she be able?
What about the threats? What about, but you know, and yes, she can. But we attribute masculinity into
power.
Yes. So what has happened is the men are still dominating the top positions. And so the women are usually having low positions with low pay. So they are more vulnerable. And because of this vulnerability, the men use their power. And I'm not saying, when we say sexual abuse and sexual harassment, even the men can be sexually harassed. I have to correct that. Because we have seen also very powerful women harass or abusing men sexually. But unfortunately, the biggest number of the harassment is women. So because of the vulnerability, it creates the space and the atmosphere of men abusing women or sexually harassing women, because they feel they can get away with it, and they know that this woman will not report anyway because no one will believe her, and anyway she will be the one to blame. You know, we blame the victims.
Perhaps she wanted it.
Perhaps she
consented, and now she's just coming out because the guy is trying to walk away.
Absolutely.
Okay. So are there any laws, any policies that protect the victim of sexual abuse and harassment?
As a country, we have made laws, or the country has made laws that prohibit sexual abuse, sexual harassment. We start with the Constitution. And the Constitution is the mother of all laws, okay? So if the Constitution under Article 33 provides for equal dignity, that women should be treated with equal dignity as men, and that we should be treated fairly in all spheres of life, including the political, the economic, and the social. Just that provision indicates that as women, we have equal entitlement, equal rights, and we're equally protected just as men. Then there's the Employment Act, which deters men any form of sexual harassment. Then we have the Penal Code Act, which provides for provisions such as rape. Rape is also an abuse against women, and sexual assault. So sexual assault, you touch my breast, you touch my butt, you've assaulted me.
Yeah, true.
Or indecent assault. Let me call it indecent assault. That is how it's provided for. So, and then we have ratified international human rights instruments, such as the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women. They talk about these things. And then at the African level, we have the Maputo Protocol. That's the African Convention on the Rights of Women in Africa. And it still provides for protection of women against any form of abuse or harassment. And I think we have a 2015 sexual offences bill that is yet to be was passed by parliament but has not been assented to by the president. And it widens even the scope of harassment to include offensive communication. Because you may be sending me, you know, emails, WhatsApps that, you know, are of a sexual nature. You're demanding for, you know, all that is sexual harassment.
Yeah, true.
And because of that, the women either lose their jobs. She cannot, you know, this man harasses her so much that he stops a promotion.
Yeah,
if it is a house help, he goes into her room, sexually harasses her or rapes her, and she cannot report to the madam or you know, and what the life goes on. He reminds her of how he buys her food, how he takes care of, you know, the bed she sleeps on. But when I came to work, this was not part of it, okay? Because we may be thinking about office work. But what about factory workers?
Yeah.
Okay? What about the housemates, the house helps, who are every day harassed? And when she walks away with nothing. And when the woman chases her, he's like, oh,
you have seduced my husband. Yeah.
And yet, the husband told her, if you ever speak, you're going to lose your job.
I will kill you.
She needs this job to fend for her old mother in the village, maybe a sick mother, her sisters, her siblings who are in school. But you know what? She leaves everything. They chase her, throw her out on the street. And we forget that in most cases, the person who makes the first advance is the man. So the women are blamed when they are sexually abused, and the men get away with it because they are men.
All right. So now, Director Ruth, there's a friend of mine who calls you Director Ruth. Yeah. Let me ask, now that you work with Uganda Human Rights Commission, I know that your biggest mandate or your greatest mandate is actually protect the rights of Ugandans. How is the execution of these policies, of these laws? Is there any success stories? Because we have a challenge in this nation of executing a law and actually bringing the victim to justice. Is there anything, like, how is the progress? Can we trust that actually if anybody risked to come out and expose the person that has been taking advantage of them, should we trust that the law or the legal process would be successful?
Okay, and I'm glad you raised that. But when we speak about sexual offenses, they're not as easy as an offense of torture.
Okay.
A car accident that compensates me, a theft, a murder. They are very complex because they involve emotions. They involve issues of body integrity. They involve issues of body autonomy. So for a woman to come out and report, it is rare. So majority, even when we talk about sexual abuse and sexual harassment, the levels, the numbers of reports of an adult woman reporting about being sexually abused or sexually harassed are very few.
Okay.
So for the children, you'll have very many defilement cases and maybe rape, you know, a bit here and there. Those ones are adults. But if it's just harassment, okay, I'm not saying not belittling it, but if it's harassment and abuse for even you, you're like, how am I going to speak?
Okay.
Then when I go to court, then they'll say, what did he do to you? How do I explain this? What about my marriage? Because the marriages fall apart.
Yeah, true.
How do I explain what he did to me? And what about the emotional bits, the aspect of dehumanizing my body, dehumanizing me and making me feel worthless like a piece of property? What about my body integrity? What about issues of my emotions where I feel I'm worthless? I am nobody. What about my job? What about the community knowing? What about my parents? So for someone to say, let me stick my neck out, it is so hard. And the men know it. So they know they will get away with it.
So they use that and take advantage. Absolutely. Some more.
So they know, and some man has said it. I heard him, I was listening, and said, you know what? You hit on them and they cannot report.
Wow.
And this harassment or abuse is not limited, even though we talk about the vulnerable women. But even the powerful women, we have had MPs. I mean, if a fellow member of parliament harasses you, where do you report? Can you report? What about your members
of
constituency?
They're even going to deny it and say it is just an allegation.
But even how do you even start? That he touched my breast, so what? They would remind you of how old it is.
Wow.
Do you understand? So these things are very complex. So because of the fact that women have been taught to keep quiet and preserve their dignity, because the men have been taught to kusajalata, male prowess, go out and get it, don't accept a no for an answer, because men have been taught that a woman's no means a yes, and because women have taught to be submissive and to be humble and not to speak about, and because sexual issues are not issues that can be spoken out in broad daylight openly. There's been a case that was lost, and this woman was raped, and when she went to court and the judge asked her, what did he do? She said, he made me his wife. Because how do you explain what he did to you? Because traditionally, you cannot explain. You can't give details. Not in an African setting. So when she says, he made me his wife, they said, please explain. What does it mean?
Wow. And that it's in itself is just traumatizing.
And that is traumatizing, dehumanizing.
For you to revisit such,
yes.
The images have got to come back for you to be able
absolutely.
To explain what
so, most of these cases then go unreported because they cause anxiety, the stress, the post-traumatic stress disorders. The women feel like they're marginalized, they feel vulnerable, they feel they are not worthy because they are called names. You are even afraid of, oh my God, is this what happens everywhere? You understand? So because of this, no one reports. There are very few, very, very few reported cases of sexual abuse and sexual harassment. But the officers are there.
Okay.
The Ministry of Justice has a department that deals a labor office.
Okay.
And we, as a commission, our doors are open. We have 23 offices around the country. Actually, call them 24 with a head office.
Okay.
Any of our offices, whether in Gulu, whether in Moroto, whether in Soroti, Jinja, Kampala, Masaka, Mbarara, Lira, Fort Poto, Kasese, the whole nine yards.
Okay.
Any of our offices is ready to receive. And we have young lawyers and lawyers who are willing to support you or support anyone who walks through those doors. If it's not even to record a statement, but to advise and point you to the right direction. Our services are really free of charge.
Wow.
And there's nothing that we have not heard of.
Wow.
Because by the time I started off as a legal officer, so there's nothing new that you're going to tell us or any of us that we haven't heard before. And the expertise, the experience that they have, at least there's none that is less below 5 years in the place.
Oh.
Yes, so because I told you, because of the attachment, you find many women, we have men as well, but we have more female lawyers because of the attachment that we tend to have to our jobs and the need to help people. So feel free to walk through our doors and then we'll see how we can help any person who comes, and especially any matter of human rights. It doesn't have to be limited to sexual harassment or sexual abuse.
Okay. So I also got to, in my research while we were preparing for this show, I did some research and I found out that every company that has over 25 employees should actually have a no sexual harassment policy in place. So is there anybody that supervises these companies to ensure that actually those policies are there and they are being respected?
Yes. Not even 20. I think 10 you should have. And I think it is just the right thing to do. Any staff that you have, there should be a no sexual harassment policy.
In every organization.
In every organization.
And most of our people do not know this. You just enter an organization and you don't even know there's a policy that can actually protect you if only you have evidence.
Because, and this is another thing that I noticed. Mm-hmm. Many men sexually harass, one, because they can, two, because they have the power, mm-hmm. but also three, because they don't have awareness. They think it's the norm. Mm. You can say four, it's been normalized, but because they do not know that it is wrong. Mm. They think every beautiful woman or any woman that I want, mm. I have to tell her anything, something. Mm. Mm. Not because sometimes he wants you, but because he feels that a female should be, you know, this should be done to this woman. Mm. And so there's need for awareness creation within the institutions, within the companies, mm. and there should be a zero tolerance policy for sexual abuse or sexual harassment. Now, when it comes to oversight, the commission has a role mm. to monitor all companies okay. and businesses in Uganda.
Okay.
And in regard to human rights observance.
Is this something that is required when you're doing company registration? Is this something? I know that is done at Uganda Registration Services Bureau. So, at what level does a company register?
The policies are internal mm. guides.
Okay.
The internal guides. So, you find that very few have them. Okay. It's usually those companies that have a linkage to international organizations because internationally it's a requirement mm. Under the UN Guiding Principles on Human Rights and the Global Compact. Mm. It's a requirement for companies that are affiliates to the Global Compact to have these policies. Mm-hmm. But majority of the companies in Uganda really don't have the, despite the fact that the Employment Act provides for it, mm-hmm. Unfortunately, majority do not have. Mm-hmm. So when we are doing oversight, unfortunately, even for the commission, we mainly look at the big companies that have very many people. Mm-hmm. So we don't go to these small little companies that have five. Mm-hmm. I mean, the others have more people to protect, not like because every life matters, mm. but we start with the big ones until we have mm. that manpower to be able to go to the small companies. So we are still dealing with the big companies. Mm. But then this is where civil society should come in mm. and help with the small companies where the commission can't reach, okay. while we still deal with the multilateral and the big companies that have big people to big numbers of people to protect.
Mm. All right, at this very point, we are just going to take a short break and our guest will take a sip on her glass of water and I do my juice. We'll be back in just a moment. Don't you go anywhere.
Win 5 Hotels and Spa is a 5-star iconic hotel situated in Nakasero, the heart of Kampala, with the highest spectacular view of the city. With over 250 rooms, expert chefs from Tunisia offering mouth-watering cuisines, the largest hotel events venues and gardens for conventions, the most advanced gym and spa surrounded by our indoor and outdoor swimming pools. Win 5 Hotels and Spa is a nipping world-class hospitality service with value for your money. Visit us for seeing is believing or call 0772-838-777. Win 5 Hotels and Spa, where luxury meets comfort.
Welcome back from that short break. You are still in the Garden of Eden with your Marejanka. Yes, and tonight we are discussing sexual abuse, the consequences, the challenges, how does it come about? What can you do to make sure that you get justice if you're willing? Eh? And of course, at the end of the day, we are going to encourage you. We are going to inspire you not to sit back and let people continue taking advantage of you. We can fight and defend ourselves, especially as ladies. Eh? And now that I have one lady that believes in not us sitting back, eh? So be ready at the end of the show. We are going to be telling you how to do that. But at this point, Director Ruth, I would like to ask you, if one wanted to actually file a case against somebody that has sexually abused them, what do they require? What must I come with? What should I present as an evidence? Where do I get it?
Okay, thank you. Mm. And thanks. The marriage anchor for raising this. You need any evidence that you can hold mm. or get your hands onto. Mm. And before I go into the evidence, I have to say and retaliate that sexual abuse and sexual harassment is a manifestation of power.
Okay.
And their power relations. And most probably, and in most cases, the abuser or the harasser is more powerful than their victim.
Yeah, true.
So the evidence you bring can either, and this is why women may not report. They know that they believe that they will not be believed.
Mm-hmm.
They will not be appreciated. They will think they brought it on themselves.
Mm-hmm.
They will be blamed, or they'll be embarrassing themselves, their families, and the institution.
Mm-hmm.
So, and other times they're told, shut up, keep quiet. You bring the institution into disrepute.
Mm-hmm.
And also you're drawing attention onto yourself, which mm-hmm. man will ever touch you again or even come closer to you again.
Mm-hmm.
So when this happened, when you're abused,
mm-hmm.
If it is harassment and sexual advances unwanted, and there's some form of communication, keep the letters, keep the WhatsApp messages, keep the SMSs. If he sends you pictures of his genitalia, keep it.
Yeah.
Okay?
Mm.
This is going to be evidence. And for WhatsApp, at least the name of the what? Of the
and
author.
The number.
And the number shows.
Mm.
So that is very good evidence.
Mm.
But what about when if it is touching and hurry? Tell a friend and tell them to watch so that you have an eyewitness.
An alibi.
Yes, an eyewitness.
Mm.
And say, you know, this guy keeps coming to my desk or coming to my room or coming to this.
Mm.
Just watch him. I want to have evidence.
Mm.
So that at least it's more than one person or two people.
Mm.
But if there's any document, there are people without phones, or what if he just keeps winking at you and doing signals?
So even winking at you is a form of sexual
harassment. Yes, and it's unwanted. Or just doing sexual acts that are unwanted. I'm not interested.
I don't want to watch, even if you don't do it in my presence. Eh?
Yes, I don't. I'm not interested. That
okay.
is, you're harassing me sexually.
Mm.
Okay,
mm.
It could be actions. It could be you just sending me, you know, profanities or obscenities or you know, pornography.
Mm.
I am not interested. That is a form of harassment.
Okay.
So sexual abuse and harassment is really wide in scope.
Mm.
And so we shouldn't limit it for just the act itself. It is everything around that act. So if it is rape, and it gets to rape, then that has gone a little too far.
Yeah.
So one, you need to go to a doctor.
Mm.
First of all, you need to report immediately,
and
then run to a doctor. And then when you get to the doctor, they are going to get semen, you know, they will. It's a very whatever procedure, but they get semen
before you wash.
Mm. So do not wash.
Mm.
So once you go and report that, the police will record your statement and then send you to a police doctor.
Mm.
That police doctor is going to get something to kind of clean your down there, and then in that, you know, they'll be able to pick samples of the semen, and the semen will link to the DNA of this person.
Okay.
So, but the trick is, do not wash. Because when you wash away
the evidence. Mm.
And also, it's very important to report.
Mm.
And be, I know it is so hard, because even rape cases take long to be reported. Why?
Mm.
Because you first go through the trauma of being dehumanized.
Exactly.
Of being made worthless.
Mm-hmm.
And I have seen victims of rape.
Mm.
She can sit there and just cry.
Mm.
Because she has lost. And then the first thing that they think about is washing. Because she wants to
wash away and feel
the
a little
pain.
Bit of cleanliness.
Yes.
On
they
your
want
body.
To wash away the pain, to wash away this man off her body, to wash away any contact.
Mm.
And unfortunately, that
by the time they think of, oh, I should have preserved
yes.
this, it's already
so,
gone.
Sometimes they tear clothes.
Mm.
It's very important to go or to go with a torn clothes or to invite police, call police. And if it is a room, sometimes, you know, the sexual act is, they can find the hairs that have fallen or whatever it is.
Mm.
Okay. But if you can, there are self-defense trainings. I wish every woman would go through self-defense.
Okay.
Sometimes they've said, ah, these empowered women take it a little too far.
It's not empowered.
And it's not being empowered. It is just knowing what to do where to hit with what body parts, okay? And if he holds you here, how to turn the head. If he does this, where to hit him, you know, whether to hit the groin, at what point, and do you have to fight immediately because it can kill you. So previously they had been in the girls' schools, they had been training on self-defense. Unfortunately, some of those things have since gone, but it's very important. And also, so the key evidence, if it is just harassment, to start. And also, not women should not put themselves in compromising situations. If you realize that there could be a danger, please excuse yourself.
Okay.
And also, tell the men that, no, I'm not available. I am not okay with it.
I cannot go with
they will respect that.
To have a meeting at the hotel.
And for the women who are working women in offices, keep the evidence, because you may need a promotion and you will sit on your promotion.
Exactly.
And then you start saying he did it because, because, and you do not have the evidence. And it will be your word against his.
Yeah.
And everyone will, if you can, keep the evidence. Okay? And you know, you can take a screenshot. Because, you know, you take a screenshot and even keep it somewhere.
But what even print it out.
But what about the house helps and the factory workers? Because now we are having so many factories and even people who work in hotels. And we have received cases of people when they're in the rooms cleaning or somewhere. Oh, the bosses pounce on them. Okay? So these are all situations.
You're not even prepared to have to record anything at that moment.
And unfortunately, for some sexual, in many some instances, if it is not if it's not rape, and it's just the two of you, it's so hard to prove. But if you have a company non-sexual harassment policy, the human resource officers should play a critical role, and they should be sensitive to the needs of the women in these companies or the men in these companies, so that they are able to support them in the event of harassment. And so it is not in every situation that you will have evidence.
Yeah.
And
but
I repeat,
prepare yourself.
Yes.
If it is going to happen again and again, and again,
yes,
it gives you enough time for you to prepare and actually set him up so
yes
that you will have the evidence.
The evidence, yes. Mm-hmm. And these days you can even conceal a phone and have a camera and then you record.
Exactly.
Only that they'll say, oh, it was preconceived.
Set
you
up.
Lured him. You know, you lured him and then you wanted to embarrass him. So, but it's very important that even the police officers, because sometimes they have not been there, there's been a lot of training on gender training for police officers, but some, even when we go to police, are not sensitive to gender issues. So she'll sit there with everyone and say, bakukozechi, what did they do to you and how, and then how do you explain? And then she's telling, or she or he is telling everyone listening to wishing to listen, that oh, she's alleging that this man, you look at her, don't you think she lured him? So the police has to be sensitive. And also, but also the companies, if it's about a company, they have to have gender and sexual and non-sexual harassment policies. And then they have to be sensitive to the needs so that there's zero tolerance for these acts. And then the people have to know what to do. Please, if you're raped, run to police immediately. Do not wash. Let them first collect the evidence. And then I know it could be uncomfortable, but wait until, because you want to catch this man. And then after you can go and wash.
Sorry to cut you short. What about for organizations? I've had a lot of friends, okay, not a lot, but some friends come and tell me that I have been dismissed because, you know, I was in an affair with my boss. You see, he promised me a promotion, and then before I discovered, I found out that he was also, you know, having an affair with the other person on the account that they would give us the same position. You find there 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, yes, and then at the end of the day they frame you and then you are dismissed, and maybe you have evidence and they present it, because this is normally Delta, this is normally, I think it's the HR department that is supposed to handle this. You report to them first.
Yes,
you report, and it is their boss you're reporting, and they don't do anything about it. What can someone do if the organization is not willing to hear your case?
You report to the labor office.
Okay.
And you can also come to UHRC. We can advise you on what to do.
Mm.
But there is a labor office in Ministry of Gender. It handles exactly that.
Mm.
And then they can institute an investigation, because this man is using his position of power and using the promotion as a bait to just lure these girls and abuse them and sexually take advantage of them. And I think it is wrong. So as human beings, if we have cameras, it helps.
Yeah,
in buildings, in offices.
In building.
Two, if the company or the institution has a zero tolerance, then people are more careful on what they do. So all companies, all government institutions, non-government and government, whether NGO, whatever it is, should have a zero tolerance to sexual exploitation, sexual abuse, because it's an exploitation. And as I've told you, this thing is a manifestation of power.
Yeah.
And that's why when you're with the UN, they tell you, in the country we go to, any country you go to, you are not allowed to have a relationship with a native, a national. Do you know why?
Wow.
Because even though they consent, that consent is not really a consent, because there is vulnerability. They need help. So for you, you go to a country which is at war, you're dealing with refugees, and you
want to have a relationship with a refugee.
Yes, we're a refugee. Do you think she'll say no? She's thinking about the food, extra food she's going to get for herself and her children.
Perhaps so thinking that
consent is really biased consent. So that is why they tell them, even if she says yes, it is not really a yes. It is a qualified yes, because she needs some. She's in a position of vulnerability. So even companies should know this, that as a boss, when you approach someone junior, she may not say no, because she feels that she'll lose her job, she'll lose her promotion. So even if she says yes, it is not out of her free will. She's just afraid of the repercussion and what she may lose if she says no. Yeah, so that is why the companies have to put in place an environment that has zero tolerance to sexual abuse and sexual harassment.
All right, so let me ask. So if if you had a daughter, you said you have one daughter? So what advice, I don't know how old your daughter is, what advice would you give your daughter if she was applying for this job and it is her only hope, and someone is asking to sleep with her, what should she do?
I'll tell her to walk away.
Okay.
She's too valuable and she's still young, and the sky is the limit. And many jobs are coming. I am sure if she went there and they used her, most probably that man, that mean, now it's my daughter, I would call him a dirty man.
Dirty man indeed.
Would not even give her a promotion. I don't think that is her job. Her job is elsewhere, where she can spread her wings and be herself.
Merit.
And on merit, where she'll be, you know. This girl, whoever it is, will never be satisfied that she's worthy. I got my job on merit. I fly. I am a free bird because I know I deserve it. So when I get a promotion, or I compete with others and I get a promotion on merit, I am happy. I can proudly speak and hold my head up high, because I know it is on what? It's on merit. It was not given to me as a token, because you have given your body away just for a favor of a job. And you may not go far. So you are never very confident that you can go far. You doubt yourself.
Okay.
So I'll tell her, walk away, and I'm sure she'll get something better.
What about the young girls that we have nowadays that actually want to, they are the ones that are going to suggest to the would-be employer, and they're like, for me there's something extra that I have from the way they dress. They are lazy, so they think they don't deserve it and they want to use the other ways, because they already know that this is something he's most likely going to ask me. So I might just as well give in and we just get done with this thing and I get the job. What would you say to the lazy ones that do not even want to put in any effort? They just want to sleep around and get whatever they want.
It breaks my heart when I listen to social media, or even watch even national TV and listen to...
Is that the reason you're not on WhatsApp?
Maybe. Because I'm like, what are we... How? When did we get here? We have poisoned our society so much. We have normalized acts of sexuality. We have normalized acts that were very intimate. Things that we used to hold sacred or sacred are normalized. Things that were hidden away and taken as valuable are not valuable
anymore.
My father and mother always used to tell me, I think it's now it's a common saying, that the most precious things are hidden. Gold is found very deep. Diamonds, you dig deep to get a diamond. And, you know, you get small portions. And then if you need pearls, you have to go to the deepest seas and oceans just to find one little pearl. But then when you put anything that is in abundance, ceases to be valuable.
Yeah, true.
So when you expose your body, it ceases to be valuable. There's nothing that is exciting that we want to see. I mean, and then the talk itself has normalized sexual activity. That it's okay because you want to, because you want a favor, that it's okay to use your body to get rich. And unfortunately, even some of the people who come out, and then I see, okay, this is the one advising the country and is saying these things, and it's I feel for the younger generation.
Yeah.
I am lost for words, and allow me to say that. Because but then I have told my daughter, my nieces, my nephews, just because everyone does it does not shouldn't make you do it.
True.
And I've said that just because someone is eating kalori should not make you eat kalori. Just because someone is eating a little bird should not make you eat this little bird. Because, you know, it could be poisonous. So, let us stop normalizing certain things. Let us call evil evil. Let's call wrong wrong and not normalize wrong. You see, once we start normalizing certain things, that you go with the nipples out, you go with the showing your... you know, this used to be private parts.
A bikini, and you're posting your pictures everywhere.
Yes, we used to call them private parts. Now I don't know whether we can call them private parts
public
anymore.
I don't know what they are called.
So
public property.
Yes. So when you normalize certain things, then how can you then report abuse? How can we protect you when you haven't been responsible enough to protect yourselves, to do the right thing, so that We all say no to certain things, so or abuses. So let the young girls not normalize certain things, because it promotes sexual abuse. And so the question was, okay, a prostitute says, "I was raped. Can a prostitute be raped?"
I don't think so, unless if you were raped before you became. Because you, I mean, this is what you do in exchange for money, from the definition of the word prostitution, so.
Okay, in law we say they can be raped, because you have to
consent,
and you have autonomy over your body. So at any point you can say no. Even though I have consented, I can withdraw my consent.
Okay.
Okay. It's only the married ones who cannot withdraw the consent, because in church you said I do.
Yeah.
But before your marriage,
it's a right of the partner.
Absolutely. But before your marriage,
we can reach the hotel room and I say no, I'm no longer
absolutely
interested in doing
this. Yes. Okay. So when he rapes you, then you can say, you know what?
He will say you're the one that turned me on. I mean, I told you what I wanted, and we came and I paid for this room. So how can you say that you do not want it yet? You already
are. Yeah. Well, I have autonomy and a right over my body.
Okay.
I make decisions about my body. But back to what we should be telling the girls.
The young people.
I think we should go back to the drawing board and see where we went wrong, and tell our children exactly what is right and wrong, and say this is no and no. You are dressed indecently, you can bring this on yourself.
Okay.
And if there's if you see anything, any advances that could lead to something else, a sexual act, excuse yourself. Don't put yourself in a compromising position. You are entering a car, you do not know where the man is taking you.
Exactly.
So then after you scream and say,
"Oh my God, I have gotten a ride."
Yes. A ride, because you see a fancy car. Do you know what you went through to get that car?
You know?
Do you know how many people have sat there before you? Because, you know, and just because he's tall, dark and handsome does not make him a husband.
Exactly.
Okay? Mm. And just because he smiles at you does not mean he's going to marry you.
Actually, I have a case. I think I'll give examples, two examples, and then we'll bring this show to a close. There's a university student that actually came to me. This is to the young girls that would want to go with whoever, you know, the stranger, and you end up in spaces that are not public enough. So this girl, they were coming from church, a certain church. I want to mention the church. So because they got out of church, the guy and the girl, they got out of church together. So they were all walking, or you're just walking different directions, and then they just end up sitting next to each other in the same taxi. So they go, they come. As they sit next to each other, they start conversing. Of course, it's normal. I mean, you were in church, I was in church, same church. So where are you going? Going to town. Oh, okay, even me, I'm going to town. So the conversation started. So long story short, by the time they reached town, they had already exchanged numbers. So I was like, oh, so that actually I can connect you. I think they talked about something and the guy promised he could connect the girl and she accepted. So the next day they set up a meeting at one of the hotels here in Kampala. So the next day she goes to town to meet this guy. So they meet at a public hotel like this one where we are right now. And then the guy, in the middle of the conversation, for him, he's planning something and this girl is just naive. So then he tells her that, you know what, my battery has died out. Can I please use your phone to call somebody? In the middle of their just talking and him trying to help out with whatever it is that he had promised to help her out with. So long story short, he goes into one of the hotel rooms and then he asks the waiter to come and ask her to come and pick her phone. I mean, the guy has your phone, eh? So you can't just walk around and leave your phone behind. So she just thinks maybe he's in the corridor somewhere. Long story short, that young girl was taken advantage of. She was raped. So I'll only stop it there. And maybe I was sharing this story for you to know that you should be as cautious as possible. You do not know this person just because you came out of the same church. You see, now church is considered to be a safe place. There's no place that's safe. Even the devil knows that. I mean, scripture says that when the children of God are gathering, even the devil comes, you know, to gather. So even in churches, these workplaces, anything can happen. So you just have to be sharp enough to sense something weird and you stop it. Leave your phone behind or wait for him. Ask the waiter to go back and ask him to bring your phone. Do not go anywhere. And then maybe I'll give my own example. I think I've given this once or twice. When I was still at school, some years back, I got this like internship placement. And this guy was, I had like a job that would last, I think, until like 4. And then I would go for my evening classes at campus. So every evening, this boss of mine would want to come and, you know, when you're showing something on the computer, he wants to come and hold you, lean behind you. You're like, what's going on, as in? So because he's your boss, you know, you're just new, you're just a student, you've not even graduated. So it's a privilege, it's an honor that you have like a job that can earn you some money for shoes or, you know, your basic needs. And I was, you know, I was very needy at the university, very needy. My father used to send me like 20 or 30 K a month of pocket money. Imagine. And anyway, let's not even go there. So you're seated and then you feel his chest on your shoulders and he's breathing on your head and you're like, what's going on? So you move slightly ahead. You don't even want to ask because you're scared. But thank God that me and you, I think we have one thing in common whereby we were raised by parents that taught us our worth and to be bold and courageous. So one evening, he makes me wait in the office until like 8, whereby most of the offices around us knew that by then the offices would be closed. So he came at around 8:30. I missed my classes and every other shop. I was even scared because the office was like in the corner. Some of these are kids down here. You know, he comes and when he enters the office very late, intentionally, then he locks the office. Because I think I had the office key, so I didn't want to leave before he could come because I needed to give him the key. So he comes in and, you know, actually he wanted to force himself on me. as very young. So thank God for the boldness and the courage that I had in me. I told him, no, if you dare, I will scream. And he told me, if you scream, nobody will hear you. They will think you agreed, like you can't dare. So I started shouting before he could even do anything, like screaming. He's like, get out and do not come back. I'm like, gladly, I will not come back to your office. I had worked for only 3 weeks. Three, it was not even a month. 1, 2, 3. So, like she said, you have to be bold to defend yourself, because nobody's going to fight for you. At that point, at that place, your mother, your father, your friends, nobody is watching, nobody is there. So you have to find the courage to say no and protect yourself. Who knows? I could have gotten pregnant.
Sure.
Because or at worse. That moment, or worse, you know, not even that. For me, actually, you always look at the emotional impact. Mm-hmm. You know, that is something that is always underestimated. Mm-hmm. You get to a time whereby if you get overly used or get so many relationships and so many people into your life, you reach a time where your emotion has a lot of, let me say, attachments, a lot of character, a lot of pieces of each one, so that you've picked from all these people, and the time comes that your heart becomes like stone. True. You don't know what love feels.
You cannot
trust. You're biased. You're stigmatized. And then these are the kind of people that end up into people's, you know, houses as wives. And then you find the husband is trying to love on you. He's trying to show you that he cares. But because of all this trauma emotionally that you have gone through, or that you have accumulated, you can't even trust the man that actually truly loves you because of what happened. So that is one of the reasons why we decided that we'd bring this topic right here, so that you will know that, yes, it is not enough for the marriage anchor to come and tell you, abstain, be faithful. No, if you're taken advantage of, protect yourself. If you cannot, let's try. At least try, and then let the law fail you. But try and do something, okay? So, Director Ruth, what is your parting shot to a young somebody that has been taken advantage of, and perhaps maybe they do not have any evidence, they've been wrongfully dismissed? What do you have to say?
I would say that you're stronger than you think. You're worthwhile. You're beautiful. You're loved. Someone loves you so much. And there are many people who want to treat you with dignity. So take care of yourself. Take care of your life. And in the event of any abuse, speak to someone. Don't die silently. I know that most of these things happen to the unmarried, new recruits, interns, or younger people below the age of 35. And that is the most productive age. We can't afford to lose you. So know your self-worth. Speak up. Don't allow your silence to destroy your life. So I wish you all the best, but talk to someone whenever something happens, and whenever you feel threatened, leave wherever you are and go to a safe place. Thank you.
I mean, I'm here. I left the job. Did I die? I didn't die.
No.
The Kalito money, he didn't even pay me for my 3 weeks, but I survived, and then now I am here. So, and maybe to just add on one more thing. You see, most of the young people, when you're in a dark place, you think you're going to die. You will not die if you turn down that job offer. You will not die. When I was very needy at the university, I needed that money. I turned it down. I protected and my dignity. I walked away with my pride. And here I am. And as long as there's night and day, light will always come. Sure. Yes, you might suffer for 1 week, 2 weeks, or for that time when you're not employed, something better is going to come, if only you can believe. All right, thank you so much for connecting with your marriage anchor, Director Ruth. Thank you so much for coming. We appreciate
Thanks
you
for having us.
Yes, when we invite you, please do come again. We still wanted to enjoy you. So before we go, I want to appreciate Win 5 Hotel Nakasero, that has now replaced Pearl of Africa Hotel. They are the ones that are hosting our show. Come check them out. Something new is happening at Win 5 Hotel. Once again, I repeat, it is the one that replaced the Pearl of Africa Hotel here in Nakasero in Kampala. You will not regret. Something new, something fresh. Thank you so much for connecting once again. Good night. God bless you.
Thank you for connecting to the Marriage Anchor. For more information, call us on 0702-767-602 or 0782-958-875. Email us at themarriageanchor@gmail.com. Like and follow us on Facebook, The Marriage Anchor. Twitter, Anchor_Marriage. Instagram, Marriage_Anchor. Check our YouTube channel at Marriage Anchor for all our previous episodes. The Garden of Eden, a test of heaven's romance.
Take me to the garden. I can't resist the feeling. Take me to the garden. I want to feel my belonging. Take me to the garden. I am yours.
And you are mine.
To the God.